Grace and peace be to you from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The theme for this morning's message is of dogs, crumbs, and gods, we pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, our Rock and Redeemer. Amen. I don't know if you all know this, but we have a dog at home. They are wonderful creatures that really remind us of how dependent we are on God, with how dependent they are on us. The wonderful character traits and personalities that dogs have particularly, I think famously they're known as man's best friend, aren't they? The way they muzzle into your lap just for attention. They may not necessarily be hungry. They just want you to pay them attention. Stroke them, pet them, make them feel good, make them feel loved. Of course, they'll let you know when they're hungry as well, though routinely, I think we feed ours first thing in the morning and after we've eaten as well, around six-ish. So this concept of crumbs is interesting to me as a dog owner. I mean, we shouldn't really feed him from the table at all. And we kind of say, no. We drop something and we don't necessarily want him to eat that crumb because it might not be good for him. He sticks to his regular diet, right? That dog food we give him. But of course we can't help but now and again give him that crumb. And he feels then perhaps more like one of us, more like a human being, more like a son. You see, and I notice I haven't told you necessarily what our dog's name is, but I think really, for the purposes of this message, then he is the dog. And this is the point. He isn't my son. He has no share in my inheritance. Yet he wants for nothing, right? He will be provided, and very well, to the end of his days, to his last day. For all intents and purposes, he may even feel like he is a son. And so perhaps we have an idea then of how Jesus treats this woman. To be giving her crumbs at all, let alone everything that she needs to sustain her life, is actually quite the grace, quite the thing to actually reveal to her that she is more than a dog. Those who are treated as more than that which God has created and given life and sustained in this world and is simply left as something that maybe isn't necessarily set apart for his purposes. Here Jesus says, no, you are in fact equal to the sons of God. I think more than revealed by his test for this Canaanite woman. Remember, she is a Gentile. That to be given the crumbs of the table is to be treated like someone who's given more than that which will simply mean that they survive. And of course, it does break down a little bit here because human beings will always be more than animals. But the Gentiles, those who are not the chosen people of God, the Jews, were treated as subhuman to a degree by them. Even if this was a corruption of the understanding of the law and the Torah given by the prophets, Moses especially. That even by the New Testament and the apostles discuss amongst themselves, well, as long as you refrain from these acts and strangled blood and the rest of it, Well, you don't have to partake in the ceremonial law like we require of even the Jewish Christians, which was interesting. But I think Jesus, by this example, in serving this Canaanite woman, really does show no partiality between Jew and Gentile, between a son of God and all inheritors of eternal life. Not just having all that we need or should sustain this life. All are inheritors of eternal life. All get a foretaste of that kingdom by virtue of having access to those crumbs. So does St. Paul reveal to us that there is no distinction, as we are all, I'm sure, in many instances in our lives, in the position where we feel like we're also dogs, treated like such, have anxiety, suffering, but that this should all lead to the betterment of our characters. And in the knowledge that God still certainly provides all we need and therefore can still have hope, perhaps even for this life, though primarily it should be for the next. And this hope shouldn't put us to shame, for we hope in the Lord, the one who does provide for all our needs, the one who, of course, created the heavens and the earth, who feeds the birds and the flowers of the field and the dogs, right? And just as even dogs have a special place in our hearts, we won't need to go into whether you're a cat lover or a dog lover. I still think there's a special place in all of our hearts for dogs. Nonetheless, their special characters and loyalty to their masters. This is the point. We really do and can mimic this loyalty to our heavenly master and Lord, the one for whom we would rightly, in humility, address and say, we deserve nothing from you. Even the great things, the plentiful things, the many means of grace he gives us, we say we do not deserve them as a dog does not deserve the crumbs that fall from the master's table. Yet, not only does he now and again say, yes, okay, not only will I give you your regular food, everything that will satisfy you, but even this treat. The crumbs really are treats, showing that I actually treat you more than a pet. You really are a son. And therefore, as God, our Heavenly Father, is our Father, we are sons of God, that is, inheritors of eternal life. You are clearly more to me than perhaps you will ever know. Those of you, again, who are pet owners may think now and again how much you love your pet and how much, if only they would know, how much you love them, how much greater your bond would be for them. But it can't be. They just aren't that sentient. But how much greater then should our bond be with our Heavenly Father? Truly as heirs, as sons. And so Jacob certainly gets a hint of this, a glimpse of this, as we are told very specifically. He wrestles not with an angel, but with a man, and then later confesses, I have seen the face of God. How amazing is that? He wrestles with a man. Jacob wrestles with Jesus, his Lord and Master, and of course, Savior, one who, like every master, would know and father would know his servant and son better and would relish the opportunity for him to know just how much he is loved. So he comes and meets his son in person. He's God. He can do anything. He can come in bodily form, even pre-incarnate, just as he sends angels to come in bodily form, though they are primarily spiritual. Think of that. Well, if he can give the gift to angels to appear to man, why not himself? Though he is not yet, by divine providence, in time, become incarnate in order to suffer and die for us, he comes incarnate for that specific reason. Until he's done that, can he rise from the dead so that we shall not perish forever, as he says in John 3. So see this. And as he has appeared to Jacob as a man, as he has certainly become incarnate, appears to his disciples as a man, appears to them for 40 days after the resurrection as a man, to bond with them and remind them that they are sons of God, that not only will they receive crumbs from his table, they will bake whole loaves of bread, so much so that they must divide it among themselves from one loaf, to remind them that they are one body in him, that they are all as precious. Perhaps raise the status of dog a little bit. Of course, he teases the Canaanite woman in order to test her faith. As we see, again, from the example of humility St. Paul gives us in our epistle lesson, of course, God has every intention of bestowing his grace upon us. Will we confess our need for it? Is his purpose sometimes in playing with us, in appearing to us as a man, in speaking to us through his prophets and apostles and pastors, if I may be so bold. Whatever position we're given, we can come to the Lord who offers his grace for us. And though we are sons of God, confess that we are not worthy to even receive his crumbs. Yet this is what he offers, and so we gladly and in faith, that is, in hope, receive it with all certainty that it is for our good. And so, to get on to that point of living, not being indifferent with sloth. Now, that's interesting. When it comes to suffering particularly, but again, taking Paul's example, the temptation is to think that I can, because this is the easy thing to do, to despair in our suffering. That is not to think much about it. To think this is my lot in life. And that is sloth. To not even think that much about it. To be indifferent about our suffering. To the point that perhaps God doesn't care. Of course he does. And it'll build your character. It'll build your endurance. It'll build your patience. You will grow in him, in the knowledge that he has suffered for you. He didn't just become man so that he could bond with you all the more, which in and of itself is such a fantastic thing to know and experience, but to suffer for you. So that he would be one who is not unsympathetic with your plight here and now. And in that light, how could we ever conceive of anything that he gives us as mere crumbs, but great morsels with which even to taste would be to know the kingdom of God in our midst? For here he is, and this is from him. For his sake, and in his name, amen. And may the peace which surpasses our understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.